I am the A and the Z, says the Lord God, the one who is and the one who was and the one who is coming, the Almighty. When I, John, saw him, I fell down at his feet like a dead man. Then he said, he laid his right hand on me and said, don't be afraid. I am the first and the last, the living one. I was dead, but now I am alive forever. I have the keys of death and hell. His eyes were like flames of fire. His feet were like glowing bronze refined in a furnace. His voice was like the sound of raging waters. And I beheld, and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne, and the beast, and the elders, and the number of them that was 10,000 times 10,000, and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power, and riches, and wisdom, and strength, and honor, and glory, and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven, and on earth, and under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in them, heard I say, blessing, and honor, and glory, and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb forever and ever. Will you please rise as we sing, He is Lord.
He is Lord.
With me. Bow down thy ear, O Lord. Hear us, for we are poor and needy. Preserve our soul, for we are holy. O thou our God, save us, thy servants who trust in thee. Be merciful unto us, O Lord, for we cry unto thee daily. Rejoice the souls of thy servant, for unto thee, O Lord, do we lift up our soul. For thou, Lord, art good and ready to forgive, and plenteous in mercy unto all them that shall call upon thee. Give ear, O Lord, unto our prayer, and attend to the voice of our supplications. In the day of our trouble we will call upon thee, for thou wilt answer us. Among all the nation and among all their gods there is none like unto thee, O Lord, neither are there any works like unto thy works. All nations whom thou hast made shall come and worship before thee, O Lord, and shall glorify thy name. For thou art great and dost wondrous things. Thou art God alone. Teach us thy way, O Lord. We will walk in thy truth. Unite our hearts to fear thy name. We will praise thee, O Lord, our God, with all of our hearts. And we will glorify thy name forevermore. For great is thy mercy toward us, and thou hast delivered our soul from the lowest hell. O God, the proud are risen against us, and the assemblies of violent men have sought after our soul. They look to themselves and have not seen thee before them. But thou, O Lord, art a God full of compassion and gracious, long-suffering, and plenteous in mercy and truth. O turn unto us, and have mercy upon us. Give thy strength unto us, thy servants, and save even the most humble and lowly of us. Show us a token for good, that they which hate us may see it and be ashamed, because thou, Lord, hast helped us and comforted us. And it's in the name of our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen.
Beyond my future, while carving my past, braver than any man that's ever lived before, Jesus, my eternal Lord. He is King of kings and Lord of lords, deeper than the valley, higher than the stars, everything I'll ever need, and so much more. Jesus Christ, King of kings, Lord of lords. Been the spotless lamb for our sin was slain,
but he conquered death forever, empowered by God's word, and still today he reigns as King and Lord, King and Lord, forever King of kings and Lord.
You may be seated as we go to responsive reading from Psalms 29, 1 and 2. Give unto the Lord, O ye mighty. Give unto the Lord the glory due unto his name. Amen. Bless the reading of God's word. Our first praise hymn this morning is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. This is an older version that I think most of us know.
King of kings and Lord of lords, glory, hallelujah. King of kings and Lord of lords, glory, hallelujah. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah. King of kings and Lord of lords, glory, hallelujah. King of kings and Lord of lords, glory, hallelujah. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah.
Will you please stand for our second praise hymn? We will glorify. Seated, and we will go to our memory verse last week for our memory verse from James 1:2 actually, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience.
James 1:3.
Good morning. I almost didn't hear you. Good morning.
Good morning.
All right. Thank you. Good to see all of you here this morning. The sun started to shine, and looks like we're going to have a wonderful, wonderful day today. We've got a lot of stuff going on today. We had kids who went to camp last week and made it home safely. And with all of their fingers, all their toes, all their arms and legs, right, Mike? And you went to camp. All the pieces are still in place. And today we're going to have a baptism, and then the kids are going to swim. We're going to have a potluck after. So our Bible study Wednesday at 6:30, and I'm still here for counseling. If anybody is looking for counseling for alcohol and drug recovery for anything else that you may desire or need counseling for. Again, I said we're gonna have a cookout here before we go over to Oil Creek Campgrounds for our baptism. All right, I'm gonna bring the kids up front that are gonna be baptized. Because I put this little thing, Syrah, Charlie. They don't know that I did this. I didn't prepare them, but we have a baptism, and baptism has always been something that very, very significant and very important to me. We go back to Jesus being baptized, and I know that many of you, we do video it, we put it on our Facebook. I know some of you that watch from home don't pick up the Facebook or video from the baptism. So I would wanted to take a little bit of time to explain, you know, the importance of baptism. These young people this winter accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior. Did you accept Jesus Christ? Did you? And did you? And I know they're a little bit shy to be up here in front, so I'm going to ask Mike to come up here in front and give his testimony. But when I baptize, the kids will all receive, or the young people, they're not kids anymore, but they'll receive, and there'll be a medallion. I hope that they'll keep with them as they grow older and go to college. And the white rose is to represent the purity of one's mother, the red carnation is to represent the strength and the bond that the father brings to the relationship. The rose, I make sure, is just a tight bud, and that represents the child. And of course, there's three: the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And we represent with the rose the child who we want to develop and grow and blossom and become a full rose and have a full life, your full life. And at some point, you know, you're going to have a testimony, and somebody's going to get up and ask you, you know, about being saved. You know, I asked Mike, come on over here, Mike. Mike's been around here probably the longest of anybody here, and one of the longest that's been here at the church, was saved several years ago, baptized several years ago. Of course, when Mike started to come around, he was like maybe this high, right? And now he's getting up here, and he just came back from Camp Judson this week and rallied the kids in Sunday school to do some of the things that he learned at Camp Judson. But you said some things the other day last week when I asked you, when we had the class about baptism and the kids, and I asked you to give your testimony a little bit, and I'm going to give you a chance to think about that, because, you know, remember what you said and what you like to say about being saved and how much that means to you and how important that is in your life and how God has blessed you. I know, like from my example, you know, I'll give a testimony, you know, that about how the Lord, you know, really has blessed my life. You know, my life was terrible. I in and out of jail and drugs and all kinds of terrible things. I committed crimes. I was just a real terrible person for a long time. And then at age 12, the Lord saved me from all of that. I didn't have to go through that. And I thank God for that every day, because I've been up as a pastor and, you know, with people who have had a testimony to talk about how much drugs they've been in their life, how much terribleness that's gone on, how many times they've been in and out of jail, how many knife fights they've been in and gun fights they've been in, and how many destroyed marriages and destroyed lives of other people that they had before they finally found the Lord. And then the Lord saved them from continuing on in that. I think that that's what's so important about that. Of course, one of my concerns as a pastor and as a therapist is that even though God saves us from all of those things, and we go, the fact of going through all of those things, you know, causes us to change a lot in our lives. It leads, you know, it wears on our life. It wears on us. We wear it in our relationships with other people and the things that we do. And that's why I think it's so important to reach young people and lead them to the Lord, so they have the ability to not have to say that, you know, I've had before women, you know, come to and say, you know, I was a prostitute and I had to use my body to buy drugs, and other people who said that they broke into houses and stole things in order to buy drugs. You don't ever have to be in that position. Then you should never be in that position in your life, because the Lord is in your life and has taken over. And if you let the Lord be the Lord and respect Him and grow with the Lord, then you should grow up, I would hope, kind of like I did. You know, I accepted the Lord when I was 12 and a half. I dedicated my life to the Lord when I was 16. I went into the military and became a commercial pilot and thought that I was doing good by being one of the leaders in the church and being able to contribute to the church financially. And then one day the Lord set me down and told me, you made a promise when you were 16. And He asked me to keep that promise. And that's what brought me into the pulpit to reach out and lead young people to the Lord, or to go into the mission field and spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. So Mike, how has your life changed? You've been saved, what, 4 years? Five now?
Yes.
And tell us how.
Well, I now, since I've had the Holy Spirit in me, it's grown tremendously. I'm no longer alone. I have someone that I can talk to whenever I need to. I just don't feel alone anymore.
Mike came, go ahead.
And now that there's even more, we can all grow in the Lord.
Amen. Mike came here after his brother had died of cancer, and he was pretty angry. He used to go out in the back and beat trees with sticks, and he was pretty angry. We saw that. Mike and I did a lot of talking, and Mike came to accept the Lord, and now he tells you, I have peace in my spirit. I know I have the Lord growing inside of me, and I study, and his life shows that all around, the things that we see in his life, the wonder of his life that he wants and I want for you guys who come to salvation and know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. That's a nice testimony. And it's a touching testimony. It's, you know, some people get excited about the hardened criminal who, you know, changed his life completely. But the life that is given to the Lord at your age is as much a wonderful testimony as any other. And you're going to have that testimony where you're giving your life to the Lord and living for Him. All right, you guys can go sit down. Thank you. Do I have any praises and prayer requests? I know Mike and Charlie went to camp. Did you have a great time at camp? Yeah. So that's a praise. And Raven's going today after our fellowship and baptism and everything. We'll get her to camp and she's going to have a wonderful time there as well. Any praises that we have this morning? Yes, Linda.
I had to drive to Pittsburgh. I had never driven to Pittsburgh in my whole life. Thank God Gene was my navigator. But we only made one wrong turn, and I'll tell you, down in that mess, that's a miracle. And the car, we didn't know about it. There was something wrong with it. We kept praying the whole way that vehicle would be all right down and back, and it was. Thank God.
All right. Praise the Lord. And praise the Lord for the good report for Eric. Yes. All right. Praise the Lord. Did you get heart riding the horses? Okay. Anyone else this morning have a praise? God working miracles and wonderful things in your life. Yes.
That my horse that my grandma's is doing
okay. That your grandma's doing okay? All right. Good for you. Anyone else this morning have a, how about prayer requests? I know that, Mike?
That the kid my sister's cat had will grow up to be big and strong.
That the what?
The kittens that my sister's cat had will be big and strong.
Okay, what about your sister? You want to pray for your sister? Okay. My sister is on the way to Erie Hospital as we speak. And his mom, who usually is here, is driving her. Yes, Charlie? For who?
Michael's sister.
Okay. Anyone else this morning have a prayer request? Yes, Jane.
For all our unsaved loved ones.
Yes. All right. Anyone else this morning? I know, Linda, you got shots this week in your knees. And so that's always a blessing when that goes. I'm getting ready to close to where I'm going to need shots pretty soon too. So, all right. Anyone else this morning? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. But first, let's go to the Lord in prayer in our song.
I love you.
Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the many blessings. We thank you for our young people, and we thank you for this day that we've set aside for baptism, and we ask you to be with us as we prepare for an important function. Lord, we just ask you to continue to be with this country. Watch over our leaders and everything that's going on. We ask you somehow to, I know that the Bible says that we will continue to disintegrate our countries and our nations, and that, Lord, we just pray for our country that we'll somehow find peace, but we know that won't happen until you come again. But help us be the Christian nation that we need to be. Help us to grow and be the example to the world around us. Lord, I ask you to be with all of those who serve on the front line in Afghanistan and Iraq and Saudi and all of the places that they are South Korea and all the places that they are around the world. We just ask you to be with them as they guard our freedom here, even though they are stationed in faraway places. We ask you to be with their families as they wait for them to return. And we pray for their mission and that they will be able to continue to carry out their mission with honor and distinction and return home to their loved ones and to the rest of us. We ask you to be with all of our police officers and sheriffs and deputies and all of those who serve us by trying to keep the peace and take care of us. We ask you to be with all of those who are EMTs and firemen and ambulance drivers and all of those who also work to take care of us. Lord, we ask you to be with this church. Help us to continue to grow and continue to reach people. Lord, I thank you so much for our young people and their draw to want to be saved, that they want to follow you. And I thank you so much for those who have, like such as Mike, who have asked you into their heart, and we see you growing inside of them and their life of peace and happiness. Lord, we just ask you to continue to be that with all of our kids, that they learn that school is getting ready, that they can come to you even for prayer for an exam, that they should be coming to you for prayer when they sit down and eat, and that they should be unashamed of you to tell everyone around them that they are Christian. Lord, we just ask you to help to give them that strength. Lord, we ask you to continue to be with this church. Help us to grow. Help us to reach the people around. Lord, we ask you to be with those who are watching from at home and all of our many friends who watch us and watch this program, Lord. And we just ask you to continue to be with them as they lift up their prayers to you. And we pray that you answer them as we come together with them as one body. Lord, we ask you to be with Mike's sister and his mom as they are up in Erie at the hospital, and we ask you to be with them as well. We ask you to be with all of our unsaved loved ones. I think that, Lord, when we started this mission, that was our goal. And I think we prayed that all the time, every time we got together. We prayed and asked you to lead our unsaved loved ones to us so that we could lead them to the Lord. Lord, we ask you to be with the Schaefer family, and we thank you so much for taking care of them as they went to Pittsburgh and for Eric's good report. We ask you to be with Linda, and we ask you to be with Charlie's prayers and his brother and the Schaefer family. Watch over them and watch over all of us. To be with my mom as she's down in Alabama and my sister who's taking care of her now. In Jesus' name and for his sake we pray. Amen. Will you please rise as we sing Name of All Majesty.
Father, our sins thou pour.
immortality, life everlasting and heaven assured.
You may be seated. Some time ago, I began us on a journey. You may have may not have known we were taking a journey. I started our trip in Revelation because I became upset, even to the point of anger, over people's concept of God and Jesus Christ. Revelation gives us the best vision of Jesus, the Jesus that we will see when he comes back again. He will be Lord of Lords and King of Kings in all of his glory. And my due, that is, that my responsibility, that which I owe him, is all my respect. And will I fall to my knees, or will I jump up and down? Me, I first going to shed tears as I fall to my knees, as John did. I thought, I'm still angered about this misconception that people have of God and Jesus Christ. That's why I took us through the Old Testament to study the fact that God's chosen children he even sent into captivity, that he took them through the desert and weaned out by death all of those whose faith was shallow, I guess, and who weren't ready to follow him to come to a pure generation that crossed over the Jordan River. We went and saw how the children of Israel then went through all the years. They were supposed to plant for 6 years and let the ground be fallow for one. But they didn't do that, and so they owed God 70 years. And so God took them, let the Babylonians take them into captivity for 70 years. And it wasn't a wonderful thing for them. So we saw in Ezra and in the Old Testament, we saw how God is this person who we really can't fool around with. That his word is his law, his word is bound. But today we want to find God to be something else. So I thought maybe the other day when I was watching TV that I had actually had a picture of hell going.
We'll be right back.
evident it is not screaming. Okay, you can shut it off. But they're jumping up and down and slamming the guitars and one of the comments was that I like so much this group who uses the name of Jesus. And that's exactly what I think, is I think that they use the name of Jesus. In my research, I was struck by the fact that this band is supposed to be somewhat Christian. And I look for and have people who follow them and think that they are a Christian band. And I look for another supposed to be Christian band. And sure enough, I found this on Hillside, from Hillside. Hillsong. Jesus, my friend.
I'm telling you, it's gonna get rowdy in here. Like old school rowdy, like no one cares.
Okay, you can shut that one off. The fact of the matter is, for me, I don't know the difference between the two of them. I'm not sure that this is the God and the Lord Jesus Christ that we were involved in studying the last several years. There are many scriptures or verses in song that talk about Jesus being my friend, but first Jesus has to be my Lord. He has to be my Lord and my Savior. We've turned Jesus into some rock pop star and God into pure love, a pure love old man who is just going to open the doors of heaven and let everyone enter. I guess probably to have these kinds of concerts in heaven, if you can imagine. I don't think that they will. And this is what seems to be coming out to be church. People will come out for this. As I opened John, saw Jesus in heaven, surrounded by millions upon millions of his created beings, and they were reverent before the Lord. John actually fell to the feet of Jesus as if dead. So I wonder, just how did we get so twisted around? Even in our responsive reading this morning, our last one, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. I'm not sure that I can accept that is in the beauty of holiness. I mean, the real reality is that what I just showed you is what we want for worship. We'll flock to see that show on Saturday night, but sleep in on Sunday morning and say we have worshiped God. But we haven't. There are so many misconceptions about God and Jesus Christ running amok these days that it is really scary. I was talking to someone the other day who tried to tell me that I should preach a more gentle, peaceful Jesus. After all, Jesus came to bring peace to the world. And I shook my head and I said, what? You've been in church all your life, all your adult life, and that's what you've learned, that Jesus is brought peace to the world. Well, let me read to you from Matthew 10, 34 through 39, exactly what Jesus says. Think not, Jesus says, that I am come to send peace on earth. Wow, wait a second. There's a person that had been in church all their life telling me that Jesus came to bring peace, right? I should be preaching a more peaceful service and that Jesus came to bring peace. But Jesus says very clearly himself, think not that I come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword. For I am come to set a man at variance against his father and the daughter against her mother and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's foes shall be they of his own household. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he that taketh not his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. He that findeth his life shall lose it. And he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it. I think these are important things for our young people who are just getting ready to be baptized to understand. that when Jesus says that he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me, that if you don't die to this world and put this world behind you, that you're not worthy of the Lord Jesus Christ. You're not worthy of salvation, the gift that he gave us. He's saying, telling us that by picking up our cross and following after him, that we lay down our lives, we lay down this world, we lay down all the dreams and all the things that we have for this world, and we follow after Jesus to spread and teach the gospel of Jesus Christ. From Luke, Jesus 12:51 through 53, Jesus said, "Suppose ye that I am come to give peace on earth." He's talking to the people, and they say, "You people think that I've come to give peace on earth? I tell you not. I tell you nay, but rather division. For from henceforth there shall be five in one household divided, three against two, and two against three. The father shall be divided against the son, and the son against the father, and the mother against the daughter, and the daughter against the mother, the mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law." This idea that Jesus came to bring peace, or that God that we studied over the last year in the Old Testament, who took the children and took them into captivity, who destroyed part of the people who came out of Egypt. He took them out of bondage, out of Egypt, and they refused to believe and obey him, and he destroyed many of them. Matter of fact, it was so bad that none of the people in 40 years, they had to wander in a desert for 40 years. And Joshua and Caleb were the only ones that crossed the Jordan, that God had to purify the nation. That Ezekiel, that Ezra brought a group back and sat down with all of Jerusalem around him and told them, and I can imagine this even happening today, that those of you who have foreign wives that are not Jewish, because they weren't saved at the time, had to send their old wives and children back someplace else. Jesus is looking for a people to call his own. But the people that I see today that want to call him his own are not the people that I think that Jesus wants, and that bothers me greatly. It is a terrible misconception we have about our Lord and our God. You know, God reverence the Sabbath, the seventh day. He said for us to rest on the seventh day. And the first day of the week was given to the Lord Jesus Christ. And I had this thought the other day, but when I was talking to this person, you know, what's the possibility? I mean, we have so difficult time getting up and getting ready for, unless it's that kind of a thing, you know, getting ready to come to church and go to church. But is it possible that heaven will be this place where we have to spend Saturdays one day resting because that's the day God has asked us to rest, and on Sunday we come to worship the Lord Jesus Christ? What would we do if we had to do that today here on earth? But that might be. Last night I was watching, before I went to bed, a program, and here was a priest that I had seen on television. I wasn't always convinced about everything that he said. He was a lot more liberal than I am, but he was a Catholic priest. On TV, on another show, talking about giving up the priesthood. That's sad. This morning, on the way to church, I had the radio on, and lo and behold, and I was listening to Fox News and Fox and Friends on the way this morning, and they had a median who was talking about listening to signs that were put in our path by our loved ones who were part of the cosmic energy of the universe. I mean, we have so much garbage being sent to us by people that don't know what they're talking about, and allowed to be on TV and spread. It's a wonder that any of our young people really get to know Jesus Christ. and the lyrics and titles of much of this music that we read. Had you ever, some of these kids love some of these songs because, boy, they got a beat and they get you going, but you listen to the words and you punch up the words and, boy, they're not Christian, and they turn my stomach. One of them, one of the newer songs is Jesus is just a friend. Jesus can be a friend. He can be my friend. He is my friend, but only if I serve and treat and respect him first as King and Lord. He is Lord. Yet, does anyone really know how to treat a Lord with proper respect? Do we even know today? Or are young people even learning today how to treat an adult? We have that problem here with our young people in the church in treating adults with proper respect. Let alone when the Lord comes, how are they going to treat the Lord? We're not learning proper respect. And that is a word we just don't use much today at all. Respect. Respect for one another and respect for the Lord. You know, the Bible says that even Satan will tremble. But we don't think that. We're full of games. A new song that is supposed to be a Christian tells the listener that Jesus, you love me as you find me. Boy, now this is just a terrible, terrible lie. You know, that Jesus loves me as he finds me. And the fact is that when you sing this song, you think that you can continue to live the kind of life that you've been living. Because this doesn't a word in that about repentance and changing. That old Jesus will love me as he finds me. But in just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. Just as I am, and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot. Just as I am, though tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt. Just as I am, poor, wretched, blind, sight, riches, healing of the mind. Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon. Here's pardon, the word pardon. Cleanse and relieve. There is no accepting me just as I am without my repentance and turning from this life. Jesus said, if you can't pick up your cross, that means you've repented from this world and you've turned your back on this world. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, that's what it means. The world behind me, I have given up on the world. It's not about you love me as you find me. And I can continue to be the person that I've been. It's like Mike has said, it's the change that grows inside that's important. Because Jesus and God cannot love sin. We've discovered that as we've traveled through the Old Testament. In order to have a relationship with Jesus, we must first repent, which means to turn completely away from those living styles in your past. To accept Jesus as Lord and live it as if Jesus was already Lord of your life. It is not something that you can say, okay, once I get to heaven, I'll change. No, the change must come now, not later. Our journey took us through much of the Old Testament and showed you a real picture of God. I have always loved the Old Testament because it teaches me how to understand God and how to have a good relationship with God. The relationship I have with God is based on God having a relationship with me, but I have to learn how to have a relationship with God, how to move my relationship and me closer to God. It's not about God accepting me as I am. It's about me accepting God and as he is. I have always marveled at Jesus calling God Father, and I wanted and want to have that same kind of relationship. I want to be able to boldly go before the throne of grace as we do here and pray and know that my prayers are being answered. And I want to boldly go before the throne of grace, before my Father in heaven. But first, I have to make God, God in my heart. The reverence and respect him as God before I can move towards God as Father. The same with Jesus. He must be Lord first. The only way I know to learn that or to teach that is studying through the Old Testament. Who is God? We learned. Truly, I hope I have helped you to see, as the writer of Proverbs wrote, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. That's a mouthful. That's a lot. That could take a long time to understand. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Our hymn of dedication this morning. Jesus, I have promised.
You're forever near me, my master and my friend. I shall not fear the battle if thou art by my side. No wander from the pathway if thou wilt be my guide. Won't let me feel thee near me, the world is ever near. In my sleep's like a dazzle, the tempting sounds I hear. My foes are ever near me, around me and within. And I, Jesus, draw thou near and shield my soul from sin. Oh, let me hear thee speaking in accents clear and still. I have both in storm and passion the murmurs of self-will. Oh, speak to reassure me, to hasten or control. Oh, speak and make me listen, thou guardian of my soul. Oh, Jesus, thou hast promised to all who follow thee that there are my glory, there shall thy servant be. And Jesus, I have promised to serve thee to the end. Oh, give me grace to follow my master and my friend. And let me see thy footmarks and in them plant mine own. My hope to follow duly is in thy strength alone. Oh, guide me, call me, draw me, uphold me to the end. And then in heaven receive me, my Savior and my friend.
You see, even in that, Jesus is first my master before he is my friend. He's my Savior before he is my friend. Will my usher please come forward for our offering this morning? Please rise.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, help us to truly understand who you are and what we need to be in your glory. Help us to live our lives to the fullest. Help us to reach others. As we go, we ask you to bless us in our going, and those at home as well. keep your hand upon us as we go about our daily tasks this week. Keep your hand upon ourselves and our homes and our cars and our travel and all of the things that we do. Be with us as we come to you in prayer. Watch over us and guide us. Be with all of our young people and all of those who serve this country. We ask you to continue to help us reach out to others around our community, to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to all of those who will listen. We ask you to help us be the people that we need to be. Watch over us and guide us. Give us each the opportunity to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to someone, to know how to lead someone to the Lord, to be unashamed, to learn a little bit about what it means to pick up our cross and follow you, to come closer to you. Help us to spread the good news that you are our Lord, our Savior, and our God. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.